At the beginning of this lesson, I told you guys that there were going to be three tests for chirality. I've already taught you two of them. One was the internal line of symmetry. Two was finding stereocenters. And now I'm going to teach you the third one. And it turns out that the third one is more of a shortcut than a new rule. So it turns out that this third test has to do only with disubstituted cycloalkanes. Okay? What are those? That just basically means a ring that has two identical things coming off of it. Okay? And these happen to be really commonly tested molecules in homework and in exams. So if we can figure out a way to figure these out even quicker, that's going to save us time in the long run. That's going to be smart. So these are really just shortcuts. What that means is that for all of these, you could use the other two rules, but if we just memorize these shortcuts, it's just going to make it even faster for us when we see these. Okay? So I want to go ahead and talk about them. There's basically three different types of rings that we deal with on a regular basis. There's what I call gem disubstituted. Gem is short for the word geminal. And later on, what we're going to learn about the word geminal is that it means two things coming off of the same carbon. Okay? So if you ever see geminal disubstituted, that is always a chiral. You don't have to give it a test. You don't need to look for line of symmetry. Nothing. It's just always going to be a chiral. And the reason for that is that there's no chiral center. Okay? If you think about it, both of these R groups here are going to be exactly the same no matter what. So there's no chiral center, so this is always going to be achiral. Easy, right? Then let's go off to the other extreme, which is para-disubstituted. Now, para is a word that we're going to use a lot more in Orgo 2, and what it means is across from. Okay? So it basically means or opposite to. Wow, that just, my handwriting is getting worse and worse. Across from. Or also opposite to. So basically, if you have two substituents that are perfectly across from each other, okay, then that's also going to be achiral. So this is also something that you can just memorize. You don't have to test it. You can just say, hey, if it's para disubstituted, if they're across from each other perfectly, then it's also going to be achiral. I don't need to test anything. All right? Now, something to keep in mind that you have to be careful about is that this is only possible on even-numbered rings, okay? The reason is because if you have, let's say, a five-membered ring, there are no two positions that are perfectly across from each other. This one, ideally, the position that would be across from it would be here, but there's nothing, there's no position there. So this is only possible on even-membered rings, like four-membered, six-membered, eight-membered, stuff like that. If you have five or seven, it's not going to work, or three, it's not going to work. All right? So cool, we've already knocked out two huge categories, gem disubstituted, paradise substituted. They're always achiral, okay? Well, what about in between? In between, we're calling that middle disubstituted. That just means somewhere in the middle between gem and somewhere between para. Basically, somewhere in between 0 degrees or 180 degrees, basically, if you're thinking of it as a circle, okay? Well, for these, it's actually going to depend where the groups are facing. If the groups are facing cis, then the answer is always going to be meso achiral. And I already showed you as an example of one of these when we did the, when I showed you guys the meso compounds and I showed you how a ring could be a meso compound. Okay? So if they're cis, it's going to be meso achiral. If they are trans, then it's always going to be chiral. Okay? You don't have to test it. You don't have to do R or S, anything like that. Just say it's going to be chiral for sure.